When you look at the word holy and you study holy and sanctify, it's taking something. It might be the same. You might have two cups that are identical. One of them is just for profane use. The other one is set apart unto use in the kingdom of God, and it should never be used for anything else. That's the idea of sanctified. Set apart for use in the kingdom. So we've been, by the Father, sanctified by Him for His purposes. And we're preserved in Jesus Christ, because He's our life, right? And we're called. We're called. It's a beautiful thing to be called. People say, what does that mean? What does it mean to be called? Does it mean I'm called to be, as Paul says, I'm called to be apostle? No, I think it's really what this is talking about, is where he says, many are called and few are chosen. He's calling everybody. There's nobody left out. Everybody's called. This sanctification and preservation in Jesus Christ is available to everyone. There's no exceptions. Most people don't see it as valuable, don't even understand that it's valuable, but it's there. So then he says this, mercy unto you and peace and love be multiplied. And this is a great way to begin everything. It's beautiful. He's talking about the fruits of the Holy Ghost all being multiplied to you. It's all given. This is what he desires. Beloved, when I gave all diligence to write unto you of the common salvation, it was needful for me to write unto you and exhort you that you should earnestly contend for the faith which was once delivered unto the holy ones. Now he's just told us we're set apart to be holy, set apart, sanctified by the Father. And he says, I want you to contend for the faith that was once delivered. What is that once delivered? Sometimes when we read that word, we think, oh, he means it was delivered in the past, it's not delivered now. Because, I mean, when you use the word once in English, you could say, well, it was once given. But I think the better way to think about it is this. He gave it, and it remains given. He gave it once. How many sacrifices did Jesus have to make? One. How many times did he need to rise from the dead? One. This is the important thing. So this faith was delivered unto the saints one time for all time. Sometimes we get the idea that they used to have it, we don't have it anymore. No, we have it. This was delivered to the saints, okay? Does everybody understand the difference there? How those things get confusing in people's minds. They go, oh yeah, they used to have faith and we don't have it anymore. Nonsense, it's not what it's saying. He says, I am exhorting you to contend for the faith that was delivered one time unto the saints. This faith has been delivered. It's been given. Who is our faith? Jesus is our faith. He's my righteousness. He's my everything. Jesus is everything to me, but he's my faith. Okay, so it was delivered. And he wants us to contend. Well, why do you have to contend? What else are we told in the scripture as believers to contend for? We're supposed to contend to enter into the rest, right? We're supposed to strive to enter into the rest. Seems a little odd. I'm going to strive so I can enter into the rest. But it's talking about a specific thing, and that's what we're going to hear here. What Jude's going to do is explain to us how we do this, what we have to do, because there's some things that we have to do. And so he wants us to contend for the faith. It's been delivered. It's been given. You just have to receive it. You just have to walk in it. Four, here's the problem. What gets in the way? There were certain men, people, they crept in unawares, and they were before of old ordained to this condemnation. Ungodly men, turning the grace of our God into lasciviousness and denying the only Lord God and our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, were these men predestinated to be these people? No. But the condemnation is upon this and has been upon this. Upon ungodliness. And that's one of the themes of Jude, is to show us the condemnation against sin very clearly. And because these men joined in with that, the condemnation fell upon them. The condemnation, just like the faith that was delivered one time and is given to all who will believe, the condemnation was stated one time and it is there for all who will disbelieve. They who believe will be saved, they who do not believe will be damned. It's very simple. Do you see the dichotomy here? It's very clear once you think of it that way. What did they do? What did these ungodly men do? They took the grace of God, the empowerment of God, the empowerment to make you a holy vessel unto him, and they turned it into lasciviousness. This is the horrible thing that he's going to talk about for us. When we look at every single one of the examples he's going to give us, they're turning the love and the grace and the desire of God to do things, they're turning it into something evil. That's what they're doing. They turn it to lasciviousness. What is that like? That's like the one who says, well, you know, I can just keep on sinning and Jesus just loves me and he understands that we're all sinners. It's complete nonsense, okay? It's very bad, not something that we love, not something that we like. All right, but we'll get back to this. Verse 5 of Jude. I will therefore put you in remembrance, though you once knew this. So this is using that once in a little bit different way. You knew this. How that the Lord, having saved the people out of the land of Egypt, afterward destroyed them that believed not. What is he talking about? We all know the story, I hope. They come out of Egypt, and there were many who did not believe. What did they do? They made themselves a golden calf, and Moses comes down from the mountain and says, all who are on the Lord's side, come over here. And everybody else got wiped out. It's pretty intense. Why? Because they didn't believe God. God had led them out of Egypt with a mighty hand, mighty miracles, and they just wouldn't believe and wouldn't trust that God was leading them someplace good. You know, have you led us out here in the wilderness to die? Have you brought us to this mountain to be destroyed of God? Because remember, in ancient times, much of their concept of who were the gods, and that was always plural, who the gods were, was very evil, because that's who the gods were. They were fallen angels, evil beings who drove men to all sorts of wickedness. I mean, taking little babies and burning them in the altars in the fire, sacrificing humans. Just on and on, the despicableness, the lascivious practices that we don't even want to talk about of the temple worship. Horrible stuff. And they drove men. If you go in, you go to Nepal or India, I've never been, but talking to people who've been, and from this church who've been, and you look at the way that their gods drive them into just miserable circumstances. It's a horrible thing. So this is how they viewed them. So when God, Yehovah, the I Am, brought them out of Egypt, they were thinking, he's going to come and kill us all. They literally did not believe that his love was upon them, that he called them, that he had purposes for them. They didn't believe it. That's why it says here, he destroyed them that did not believe. They just did not believe. We believe God loves us. We believe that he sent his son because he loved us so much. This is the scripture that if nobody knows any other scripture, they know God so loved the world that he sent his only begotten son, that whosoever might believe on him might be saved and have eternal life. This is the difference between what the children of Israel were thinking God was going to do with them, that they did not believe. They would not believe that he loved them. Moses said all of those things to them. We don't have time to go back and read all of Exodus, but he said what God was going to do, and he's going to lead them out with a mighty hand, and he demonstrated himself and showed his love for them, and he blessed them, and he healed them all. What more could he do? But they still did not believe. They were so indoctrinated in their lascivious ways. So that's the first one that he talks about. We need to remember something. Those that do not believe, God destroyed them. It's very simple. Number two, the angels, which kept not their first estate, but left their own habitation, he has reserved in everlasting chains under darkness unto the judgment of the great day. What is he talking about there? You know, there's very little scripture on this subject, but there's enough for us to make and understand the doctrine. Where do we begin? Genesis chapter 6 talks about the fact that the sons of God, who we understand to be angels, left their habitation in the heavenlies. They came down to earth and they cohabitated with the daughters of men because they found them so beautiful. And they had children of those women, giants in the earth. And there were giants in the earth in those days, that's the days before the flood, and also after those days, the days after the flood. We know those giants as we know about Og, king of Bashan, with the gigantic bed. We know about Goliath. We know about Goliath's brother. And we know about some others that are unnamed and various giants. We read in the scripture about many giant races that were destroyed not only by the Israelites, but by Moabites and by the Ammonites and by the Edomites. They destroyed giants as well. Hey, this was not a minor issue, but they were there to infect the land. Now, before those days, in the days before the flood, I mean, we just don't know what was going on, but there was a lot of this going on. And we're going to get back to that subject in a minute, but I wanted you to understand a couple of places. This is also in 2 Peter 2. I mentioned to you that 2 Peter chapter 2 is an absolute parallel in many ways to Jude, and we're going to look at it a little bit. But it also mentions this particular thing. So we got a couple of witnesses there. We got Genesis chapter 6 talking about it, and then we'll talk about a few other things. But they reserve these angels that sinned. They sinned in this way, and God chained them under darkness and reserved them. And in Revelation, some of them get loosed, or maybe all of them. They get loosed. They get unchained and set out on men. It's pretty ugly. It's bad. You don't want to be around in those days. Yeah, it's, well, we're setting, what she asked about was, you know, in this generation, we see people accepting all these strange things. None of this is happening right now, but we are being set up, yes, to receive it. So you've got people that are accepting of many things that are evil so that when that day comes, it won't seem so shocking. It's going to allow people to slip on into it in their deception. Okay, so we've got, he destroyed those that did not believe. He chained up the angels that sinned. What's the theme here? You sin, you die. Even as Sodom and Gomorrah, everybody's favorite thing to talk about when we talk about these things, and the cities about them, in like manner, giving themselves over to fornication, going after strange flesh, are set forth for an example, suffering the vengeance of eternal fire. They are the first fruits, in a sense, of what eternal fire looks like. Fire and brimstone that destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah. These were gorgeous cities. People don't understand that. They were very powerful cities. They fought with the kings from up north, and that's where Abraham got involved in that. These were big, powerful, beautiful cities, but they gave themselves over to fornication and going after strange flesh. Okay, what is that? What's strange flesh? Basically, that which was not made to be. Okay, homosexuality, big part of, that's why we call homosexuality sodomy, because it's from Sodom. Okay, that's one reason. They also tried, remember, give us those beings that came down and went to Lot's house, that I believe really almost to be two members of the Godhead. It might have been Jesus and the Holy Spirit for all I know, but I don't know that. But they could have been two angels, doesn't really matter. They wanted to know them, so they blinded them all and then took Lot and left. They were trying to go after them. They wanted this kind of strange flesh relationship. The relationship that those angels that got chained in under darkness, that same strange flesh relationship, that's what they wanted. That's what they were after. They looked for that because to them, that was how you gained power. When you read ancient history and you study all the stuff that goes on around it, there's a lot of this where, you know, he's the son, you know, Hercules was the son of Zeus and some mortal woman. It's the same thing. Josephus, who's a chronologer from the first century and talked about history, and he gave a Jewish history that parallels the Bible for the most part, said that these were the ones that the Grecians call giants. Because remember, they had their Greek mythology that then became Roman mythology and got involved in all the post-Roman mythologies as well. That same stuff, it is it is an understanding that this communion of men and angels is a big part of what goes on. So when you read this strange flesh thing, that's all I think about. It's like, ooh, this is terrible. Okay. And they suffered the vengeance of eternal fire. So them that did not believe were destroyed. Those that didn't keep their first estate were chained. Those like Sodom and Gomorrah that went after fornication and strange flesh, they suffered the eternal fire, which is what's going to happen in the end. God's going to renovate the earth with fire. Likewise, goodness gracious, it's overwhelming. Likewise, also, these dreamers, these filthy dreamers defile the flesh. They despise authorities. And they speak evil of dignities. These are people, they think that they know better, they know what they're going to do, they don't care about anything, they don't care about any authority, they don't care about any dominion, they are just filthy in their thoughts. Who's he talking about? These men crept in unawares, we're back referring to them. They crept in unawares, ungodly men that turned the grace of God into lasciviousness. That's these guys, okay? No concept of following that which has been delivered. No concept of leadership in the church. No concept of the body of Christ Jesus, which we're going to see in Revelation, which is why I wanted to do Revelation 2. They have no concept of this authority. So they do their own thing. Now I know better. And what do they lead themselves to? What do they lead men to? There have been so many church splits over the years, over arguments about how things go. Nobody following the leadership that God had set. Nobody praying for the leadership that God had set. Nobody crying out that the head would be all in all and everything in the way that God sent it. But instead, they know better, so they go running off to do their own thing. And the way that they attract men is through their lascivious doctrines. They don't say it that way. And it's been, you know, every split seems to lead us a little further down that road. And now it's the mega church split. You know, we're going to have all these mega churches. And I mean, there's nothing wrong with a big church. There's nothing wrong with that. It can be very godly, but they often degenerate over time because so many of these men crept in unawares, hide in the corners. It's, you know, it's one of the problems with a very, very big church. You know. But anyway, I digress. But what you're seeing is that what he's talking about is that we need to beware of these kind of things. And he's given us examples of what to beware of. So these filthy dreamers, they defile flesh. They despise dominion, speak evil of dignities. Yet, to give you a contrast, Michael, the archangel, when he was contending with the devil, he disputed about the body of Moses, did not bring against him a railing accusation, but said, "The Lord rebuke you." Now, can I find that anywhere else in the scripture? Where can I find it?
Zechariah 3.
And what does it say?
The Lord rebuke you.
The Lord rebuke you. Yes, so it's an example of when Joshua, the son of Josedek, is there. But what I was really referring to, because you're correct, what I was really referring to was Moses' body. We know that God took his body and buried him in Moab. It's in Deuteronomy. We know that, so why did he do that? What's going on here? God took Moses and he went and basically hid where he buried him. In a sense, it's pretty wild when you think about it. And so what this is, I think, referring to is where the devil's going, no, he's mine. Because see, death has not been destroyed at this point. Every man has to die. The last enemy is still yet to be destroyed. Jesus conquered death, but the last enemy has not been destroyed yet. But at that time, the devil had right. And so basically, they're going to strive over the body. And Michael just says, "The Lord rebuke you." And then in the same way, in Zechariah, as Christopher was telling us, when Joshua, the son of Josedek, is there and the devil's coming to assail him, the Lord stands up and says, "The Lord rebuke you." And this is a brand plucked out of the fire. And I mean, it's a wonderful statement of how God does this. But what it's really referring to is Michael, who is very powerful. I mean, he's one of the highest beings in God's kingdom that we know of. He doesn't even go, "Look, that's mine, get away from it." He says, "The Lord rebuke you." Because he understands authority. Just like Jesus is so amazed at the centurion who understands authority, says, "Look, if I say to my men, go, and they go, and I come, You have authority. All you have to do is speak the word and it'll be done. He recognized Jesus' authority. We have been given authority. But what is our authority? In the name of Jesus. In Jesus' name, I rebuke you. That is our authority. We don't go in our own name. Even though the devil goes, well, you know, Jesus I know and Paul I know, but I don't know who you are. And go, oh, he would know who Paul is. Look, Paul, in Jesus' name, he cast them out. He didn't do it in the name of Paul, even though he had that great authority. And you could say that it was Paul's authority. Yes. What was his authority? In the name of Jesus. Same authority you have. All right, so we digressed a little bit more, but this is important to understand that there's not a lot about this subject, so people read this and they don't know what it's talking about. But we just need to understand that there seemed to have been an argument over the body of Moses. And there's many things to be said, but we'll leave it there. But, verse 10, these speak evil. Who are these? This is those men crept in unawares, turning the grace of God to lasciviousness. They speak evil of those things that they do not know. They speak evil of things they don't even know what they're talking about. They just speak evil of things. Oh, he was mean to me. Oh, he was this. And oh, he meant me bad. They just say things that are complete nonsense. They just speak evil, calling people into question over nothing. And that's really what he's talking about here. But what they know naturally, so what they think they've judged in their own mind, and they've come up with an understanding, I've judged this to be this way, and you're wrong, and you've mistreated me somehow, right? As brute beasts, they're like just, a brute beast is never thinking about the consequences of the future or what happened in the past. They're only worried about right the moment. That's a brute beast, okay? It can be the gentlest dog around, but as soon as you don't feed it for a while and then you're holding food up, it's gonna go after that thing with everything it's got in it. Because it's a brute beast, and at that moment it needs food and it doesn't care how it gets it. It's not thinking about the consequences. It's a brute beast, right? So this is them. They judge things naturally by their own assessment of how things work. And by this, they cause all sorts of trouble. And what they say is they speak evil of things they do not know. It's just like when I'm upset at somebody I love, all of the church, my family, my wife, whatever, if we're upset over something we don't even know is true. There's a problem. I'm upset. And so then I speak out of my upset, and what I do is I give power and strength to the division, the divisive spirit that comes to cause division. This is what these guys do. Constantly living in this naturally minded judgment of what they think other people think of them. Somebody walks by you in the hall and doesn't smile at you, and you think, oh, they don't like me, or they're really mad at me. They think that of this, they despise me, they mistreat me, whatever it might be. I'm sure nobody here really has too much trouble with this, but the point is that it is a problem for many people that they judge in their natural mind. And this is, just think about it. This is how these people got to the point where they come in and turn the grace of God to lasciviousness. It starts there. It starts with the offense. It starts with the upset over how you mistreated me and my naturally judged how you don't care about me. And you don't realize how much that person may have been on their face praying for you the day before. I have no idea. They were crying out to God, bless them. Bless them, Father. Strengthen them. Keep them in the right way. And then you think, oh, they hate me. You don't even know what you're talking about. Right? They speak evil of those things they do not know, and what they know naturally as brute beasts and those things, they corrupt themselves. Because it brings corruption. You know that where there is strife, there is every evil work. So the devil will work on the people of God with strife before he'll work anything else. He tries to cause strife so that there'll be division. That's why Paul said, I hear that there are divisions and fightings among you. Are you not carnal and walk as men? What's he talking about? Brute beasts. You're carnal and walk as men. This is it. It's so subtle the way it comes, because most people that have trouble with it, they don't even recognize it. They don't recognize this what happened because they think their judgment is true. I figured this out. I believe that this is true. I believe you did this, you're thinking this, you mean this, you're doing this to me. And they think it's true, and then they respond with that reflexive reaction, saying, I'm gonna be upset back at them, mistreat them back. And what we create is we create division, we create strife, and we allow the powers of darkness to enter in. And the end of that is those things we've been reading about. All right, enough said of that. Verse 11, woe unto them. Woe. Woes are never good. For they have gone in the way of Cain. What's the way of Cain? He slew his brother because his own deeds were evil and his brother's were righteous. Wow. That's intense. To give an accusation against your brother, for me to, I use Christopher because he knows I love him. For me to point at Christopher and say, you've mistreated me. You've not been right in the way that you've dealt with me. To point my finger at him and to accuse him of mistreatment of me, all I've done is open the door for these things. What if he really did mistreat me? What do? I bless. I bless and curse not. I bless him. What else do? I get on my face and cry out to God for him. And if the relationship is such that I can do it in the Holy Ghost with no personal animosity, I can go to him and say, Christopher, you know, this is a problem and we need to get this right. Forgive me for anything I've done against you. And hopefully he'd do the same. I know he would. But the point is, that's the way we're supposed to deal with it. But what happens here, they've gone in the way of Cain, which is they're upset. Abel didn't do anything to Cain. He did nothing to Cain that we know of. I mean, we don't know all the details of their relationship, but he did nothing to Cain. He just brought the first fruits of that which God had commanded him to bring, and he slew the animal and laid it before God as a testimony, just as God had done for Adam and Eve, a testimony of the Redeemer that was to come. And that's why God looked at Cain and said, look, if you do well, will you not be accepted? There's a sin offering right here. Just take it and offer it. But Abel refused to do it. Cain refused to do it, thank you. Cain refused. He was too upset by how his sacrifice that he had worked on and worked so hard to bring was not accepted. I read something many years ago. I read something where a pastor was talking about how difficult it was to deal with certain types of people. And he said, you know, there was a lady in our church, a sweet lady, and she worked on this painting. And it was a horrible painting. I mean, it just, you know, bless her heart, it just was a horrible painting. And she brought it in, and she wanted to give it to the pastor so he could hang it up in the foyer, right in front where everybody comes in. And it was just this horrible painting. So the pastor didn't do it. And she got so offended that she left the church because she'd been there forever, because he didn't hang her painting up in the front of the whatever. He says, what do you do? How do you respond to that spirit? But the same thing. I worked so hard and you didn't accept it. I'm sorry. What can I do? But God does the same thing. He says, there's a way, right way. Okay? It would be wrong for me to just go and do something like that, just say, I'm going to redecorate the front of the church, unless I've got some authority to do so, or if I've got an idea and I bring it to the leadership and say, hey, I'd like to do this, and they'll go, do whatever's in your heart to do. Good, go do it. I don't want to give people the idea they shouldn't ever do anything. I mean, yeah, you should be doing things. You should be praying about things. You should be reaching to God about doing things. And I mean, it's wonderful if somebody brings flowers in here and does, you know, tries to make them better. But it's also the humility to recognize that if it's not accepted because it just isn't quite what's needed, then don't get offended. It's okay, we're gonna learn. Well, anyway, you can see how these things, we talk about fire and brimstone on Sodom and Gomorrah, we talk about lasciviousness and the fornication of angels, but all of this stems from these subtle things. That's the point here. It's this subtle stuff, these little things where we just run around doing our own thing, naturally judging stuff that gets us into trouble. And we're going to find out how to fix this here in a minute. They ran greedily after the error of Balaam for reward. What was the error of Balaam? The error of Balaam was simply this. He wanted the reward that they were going to give him. And he couldn't get it prophesying against the children of Israel because he couldn't prophesy against them. It wasn't possible. So he couldn't get the reward. So he found another way to get the reward. He told Balak how to deceive the children of Israel. But he was so interested in that reward, he did everything he could to make it come to pass. Didn't care about God's purposes. Didn't care about God's what God desired. Didn't care. He wanted that reward. So don't be that people. And they perished in the gainsaying of Korah. Korah is in Numbers, or is it number 16, I think. Number 16. And, I'm not going to spend a lot of time reading all of it. You can go read it yourself. It's a very important time when the people of Israel, a number of them, and what's fun to do is if you draw a picture of the camp of Israel, I did this 30 years ago, draw a picture of the camp of Israel and you put where all the people resided, it tells you in the south were these three tribes, in the west were these three tribes and all that. And it puts it all around. You'll find that all the tribes that from the beginning of Numbers to the end of Numbers lost population, they are all in the same area. In other words, hanging out with the people like this is not a good plan. Just don't hang out with them. Now, the people that were up in the northern part of the camp, they weren't down where these guys were. They didn't have a problem. Not as much, anyway. And the Korah was part of the Kohathites, which is one of the divisions of the Levitic. They were the southern part in the camp of where the Levites were. So they were right next to the tribes that lost the most people. So it's a really interesting study to do. You just sit down and you start at the beginning of Numbers and you write down all the how many, because it numbers them all, how many people there were, and you put them in their position on the camp. Then you go to the end of Numbers and you look at, okay, how many people were there at the end, and you see the losses and you go, wow, they're all congregated right here, and the Kohathites right there. Well, Korah was one of the leaders of the Kohathites. That means they had an extremely important job. These were the number one group of priests that ministered before the temple, before the tabernacle. They had very important jobs to do. And he felt, and Dathan and Abiram, who were leaders in some of those tribes that are just south there, felt that they were just as important as Moses was. They weren't content with where God had put them and what he had given them. They wanted Moses' seat. So they led a rebellion against Moses. And when they come up, and you know, the way the scripture is written, it's something like they came and said, are not all the people holy? You take too much upon yourself. Now there's a lot more, I'm guaranteeing there's a lot more to this, but that's a summary of what's going on. And what's Moses' response? Yeah, no, he fell on his face and he began to cry out to God for mercy. And then he rises up and says, bring every man his censer. Okay? We'll see what God chooses. And the earth... I don't know that Moses knew what was going to happen, but he was following what God told him to do. I believe that. And the earth opened up and these people went right down into hell. No passing go, no collecting money, nothing. Boom, right into hell. Okay? They just, boom. Because they were doing what? Speaking evil of dignities and refusing authorities and despising dominions. And they had great responsibility because they all had very high level positions. So their responsibility is even greater. And they led rebellion. And that rebellion resulted in a lot of people getting swallowed up by the earth. That's a pretty intense thing. So I always imagine it is that it happened right down near the south of the camp, you know, a bunch of people there. And there's a whole bunch of people probably just weren't even part of any of that. You know, we often think it's like all the people of Israel. I'm not sure it was all the people of Israel. There were probably a lot of people watching. You know, I don't know how it worked. But the camps were spread out all the way around the tabernacle. It was very large space. Walking from one end to the other would have taken quite a while. So anyway, they perished in the gainsaying of Korah. So we've been given examples here. We don't want to hate our brother, especially without a cause. We don't want to run after reward, making that our goal. And we don't want to be those that despise dominions and dignities and lead rebellions, ever. He says, don't do those. Who are these people? Remember, we're still talking about those people that crept in unawares, that turned the grace of God into lasciviousness. The, you can sin more or less every day and get away with it. It's okay, get drunk, it's fine. No problem, God knows, he understands. That's the messages that they preach, right, today. That's how we hear it today. You know what these are? They're spots in your feasts of charity. You know, in the early church, they had a lot of times where when they came together around food. They come together around a feast because, you know, that's actually what much of the worship in the Old Testament was. They'd get together and they'd offer sacrifices and they'd have big meals. There was the one, I'm sure you've read it, where they sat down and ate with God. God was at the head of the table and they were all sitting there eating and talking to him. That's pretty intense. That's just, I get shaky all over when I think about it. There's spots in your love feasts. There's spots in your feasts of love. There's spots. You're supposed to be coming together, just rejoicing in the things that God has provided for you. And there's spots in it. They feed themselves without fear. They're sitting there like acting like there's no problem. Yet all the while, they're bringing in this lasciviousness. They're clouds without water. They just, you know, they're hovering around, but they bring no rain. They bring no refreshing. They're carried about by the winds. They're moved by all sorts of natural things. They're trees whose fruit withers. There's no fruit on the tree. It's just, it doesn't last. Without fruit, they don't even have any. There's some that the fruit withers, and there's some they don't even have any. They're twice dead. That's pretty brutal. And they're plucked up by the roots. There's, the roots just have no purchase in the earth. They're just plucked up. They're raging waves of the sea, foaming out their own shame. Many times when people get angry about stuff and they start condemning other people and complaining about how things are and they rant against, you know, the leadership or they rant against something else, this is what they are. They're raging waves of the sea. They're foaming out their own shame. So what they're showing is who they really are. They don't realize it. They think they're condemning you. But what they're doing is they're showing forth their own shame. And people do it all the time, which is really sad. They're wandering stars. You know, that's the, I'm in this church, then I'm in that one, then I'm in that one, then I'm in that one, you know, just wandering around. To whom is reserved what? Blackness of darkness forever. That's pretty intense. I don't want to be that one. So what's my warning? My warning is not to be these people. And then there's more. And Enoch also, the seventh from Adam, prophesied of these. And he said, where did he prophesy, by the way? I brought my copy of the book of Enoch. This I got many, many, many years ago, back when this is the only way to get it. Now you just go online, type book of Enoch. This is not a canonical book. In other words, we would never preach doctrine out of here like we would from the scripture. But this quote that Jude puts into the scripture comes from here. So it's quite an interesting book. This book, I mentioned I would talk about this a little bit, this book gives you a lot of detail about the angels that sinned and left their first habitation and came and dwelt amongst men and cohabitated with the daughters of men. This tells you a lot about it. It's a tough read. What most people believe is there's a lot in here that is, if you took the book of Enoch as it was originally delivered and probably Jude had, it might have been a canonical book in a sense, but there's been a lot added, so it's very hard to tell what was that, what wasn't. So we just go with the one scripture is clearly, you know, something that God thought was true. You can look around it, but it fleshes out the concept that there was angels that sinned. And it's fun to read. Just don't get too wrapped up in making doctrines out of it. But it tells you a lot about it. Because he says, this is what Enoch said about these, okay, these people. Behold, the Lord comes with 10,000s of his saints, or myriads of his saints, or really just it's an innumerable number of saints, to execute judgment upon all and to convince all that are ungodly. He's going to convince all that are ungodly among them of all their ungodly deeds which they have ungodly committed and of all their hard speeches which ungodly sinners have spoken against him. You know, when you speak against leadership in the church, you're really speaking against God. That's what Moses showed us. They spoke against Moses, but they weren't talking against Moses, they're talking against God. Because God's the one who set it up. He's the one who put Moses in his position. Remember, Moses tried to get out of it. I don't want to do it. I can't talk. I can't go. They won't believe me. Lord, I can't do it. I can't do it. I can't. He gave every excuse in the book. And yet, God said, no, you can go. In fact, he even gave him Aaron for a mouthpiece. He gave him a staff. He did everything he could. But he sent Moses. I mean, Moses was not trying to lord it over the people of Israel. Let's just suffice it to say that. It's very clear that was not his goal. We can see that clearly. But that's what they thought, that Moses took too much upon himself and made up his own way, and not understanding the absolute meekness and humility of Moses that was such that everything he did was because God told him to do it, even things that were very hard. So they've spoken against him. These are murmurers, complainers, walking after their own lusts, and their mouth speaks great swelling words, having men's persons in admiration because of advantage. But beloved, remember ye the words which were spoken before of the apostles of our Lord Jesus Christ, how that they told you there should be mockers in the last time, who should walk after their own ungodly lusts. These be they who separate themselves sensual. Remember we talked about the earthly thinking? Having not the Spirit. So this is the conclusion, this entire thing, 19 verses, most of which have been spent telling you all the things that are wrong about these people that creep in unawares. But now we're going to get down to the fundamental difference between us and them. Because we've seen what they do. They murmur, they complain, they walk after their own lusts, they speak great swelling words as if they had something to say, and they look at men trying to impress men. Right? Who did that? We have an example of that in Simon the sorcerer in the book of Acts, who wanted to impress men. He wanted men to follow him. He wanted to be impressive. And he so much wanted to be impressive that he even offered money for the power, ability to give the Holy Ghost. And then Peter just looks, you don't have any part with any of this. Clearly, you're in the gall of bitterness. Absalom was another one who just couldn't wait to take the kingdom, so he had to take it from his dad and slander his dad, slander the King David. I mean, it's these are all examples of these kind of things that happen. But here's the key. They separate themselves sensual. See, they go out from us to prove they are not of us, as John says. Okay, they separate themselves. Sensual, earthly thinking, judging everything by the senses. What they see, what they think that they see, often deceived. Your senses are often deceived. Your perceptions are completely wrong many times, right? They don't have the Spirit. They just don't have the Spirit of God. They don't have it. You go to churches where there's nobody in the church has the Spirit of God. Or maybe there's just a couple of people in a corner crying out to God, saying, help us, recognizing that there's no Spirit of God there. It's terrible. It's a horrible thing. But now comes the good part. But you, beloved, you loved of God, building up yourselves on your most holy faith. Remember, contend for the faith that was delivered that one time unto the saints, that faith that's been delivered. Building yourself up on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. This is one of the reasons, one of the scriptures that makes it very clear why praying in the Holy Ghost is so important. I mean, it's not just an optional, you know, take it or leave it kind of thing. It's important. It edifies you. That's what Paul said. He said, he that prays in an unknown tongue edifies himself. There is nothing wrong with edifying yourself. Now he says, now that you've edified yourself, you can't give to somebody something you haven't received. If I haven't received peace, I can't come to you and give you peace. I can only give you peace if I've received it. I've got to be edified first before I can edify you. I mean, people get this idea that somehow that's like some terrible, edifying yourself is some terrible thing. It's a great thing. So what he says here is you're praying in the Holy Ghost. It's building yourself up on your most holy faith. You're being built up because the Holy Ghost is praying for you with words that cannot be uttered in ways that are so beyond what anybody understands. He just begins to change you on the inside. He begins to make differences in your life. And then out of that comes the greatness. But I mean, praying in the Holy Ghost, keep yourselves in the love of God, looking for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ unto eternal life. You want to not be all these things in the first 19 verses? Here's how you do it. looking for the mercy of God. Lord, be merciful to me, a sinner, is the first place you start. Now, you don't have to stay there, but you never want to go down the way the Pharisee went, where you begin to talk about how great you are. Oh, I've done such a great job of separating myself from the world. No, God didn't receive that prayer. What we do is we build ourselves up on our most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost, knowing it has nothing to do with us. I can't pray in the spirit of my own strength. I mean, that should be obvious, but sometimes people don't realize that. I can babble, I can make some funny noises, but I can't pray in the Holy Ghost by my own strength. How am I going to know I get the Holy Ghost? Because I'm going to ask Him. I'm going to ask God for the Holy Ghost. You know, biggest problem we have is with the receiving so many times is people are afraid. Well, it's going to be me. It's going to be this. Look, in all the honesty of your heart, just say, God, I don't want it to be me. He believes you. Now He's going to give you the real. I mean, we have to be confident in God. We don't want to be them that believed not. They didn't believe. They saw all the miracles. They came and they still didn't believe God was going to be blessing them. Don't believe them. He destroys those people. Believe Him. He'll give you what you ask for, right? So in your most holy faith, you're building yourself, praying in the Holy Ghost, and you keep yourself in the love of God. In the love of God, you're never looking at people as, I need to destroy that person. I need to tear that person down. I need to harm that person. I need to put them in their place. Don't do that. It's not your job, okay? When a pastor has to rebuke and correct the people, it's a fearful thing, believe me. It's not done lightly. But it needs to happen because every son that God receives, He's going to correct. Why? Because He loves us so much. So when you keep yourself in the love of God, you know, there may be situations. Some of you may be parents someday. You're going to have to rebuke your kids. You're going to have to correct them. It's one of the places you begin to understand what it's like. It's a very difficult place to be. But anyway, keep yourself in the love of God. Just love people. Just love them. Bless them. Honor them. Just glory in God and then pray for people. And of some, have compassion, making a difference. See, some of them you can go to and you can help them with their problem. They come to you and say, I think the pastor hates me. Oh no, I know how much he loves every one of us. He doesn't hate you. It's just that simple response. You're not mad at them. You recognize what's going on. You know, maybe you need to rebuke the devil. Maybe you need to do it out loud. Maybe you just need to go pray for them. Father, I come against every one of those stupid devils trying to create division and whatever. When you don't know what to do, you go to prayer. You begin to say, Lord, I see this need. I don't understand it. And you begin to pray and then let the Holy Ghost pray. He does a great job. Help people, but have compassion, love people, make a difference. Others you save with fear, pulling them out of the fire, hating even the garment spotted by the flesh. What is that talking about? Remember, spots these are in your feasts? They have a garment spotted by the flesh. They don't have the spirit. They're in the natural brute beast kind of thinking, and they're headed for eternal fire. They're headed for eternal destruction. And so, you know, the eternal destruction is coming on Sodom, and there's Lot. Abraham prayed for Lot. God got Lot out. Save him, you know, pulling him out of the fire. It's pretty intense. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling. Now this is intense. He's able to keep you from falling. You know, you can be kept. Because this is one of the things that people get messed up on. Just now we're talking broad themes here. One of the problems people have is this whole concept. You'll hear terms, Calvinism, Reformed theology, various things like this. It's the idea that once you're saved, you're always saved. You can never be unsaved. Nothing bad can ever happen to you. Some are destined to salvation. Some are destined to destruction. God knows. All this kind of stuff. That pervades much of what people think. And you can find websites that spend their entire job is to convince people this is all true. The trouble is there's some of it that is good things. The scripture will be in there, whatever. Because God says He'll keep you from falling. He will. But what do you need to do to be kept like that? Build yourself up in your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost, and keep yourselves in the love of God. 1 John tells us, we know whosoever is born of God does not sin, because he that is begotten of God keeps himself, and the wicked one does not touch him. There's a keeping yourself that you need to do. But that what keeping yourself is you relying upon the Spirit and not your fleshly understanding, not your earthly understanding, not your carnal mind, not the way you think, not your brilliance, not your experience, not your knowledge in the things of the world. If you rely upon those things, then you're going to have a garment that's spotted by the flesh. And it's not going to be holy and able to stand before God. And he's going to have to pull you away from that. He's going to have to teach you how to walk away. He's going to have to wean you from that. You have to say, no, you can't rely on yourself. You have to rely on the Spirit. This is very important. Now in him is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before his presence, before the presence of his glory, with exceeding joy. To the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and ever. Amen. That last part is so compacted and filled with just intensity of what God wants to do for us, that you could just sit there and dwell in verses 20 through 25, just sit there. And this, Lord, this is what I want to be. This is what I want to be. Lord, I thank you for making me this. That's what you want to be right there. And God will present you faultless. See, you don't present yourself faultless. Lord, I've gone over here and I've created an edifice of faultlessness and I'm going to present it to you. Will not work. It will not work. It'll be burned up. But the Lord will present you faultless when you rely upon him, when you call upon him, when you give yourself to him. Praying in the Holy Ghost, we keep ourselves. It's amazing. I just quickly want to go over to 2 Peter chapter 2. Just 1 second. 2 Peter chapter 2. I just want to show this to you so that you understand, because I mentioned this. Chapter 2, verse 4. Well, it's verse 1. Does this sound familiar? I'm going to do this really quickly. There were false prophets also among the people, even as there shall be false teachers among you. What did we say? Well, who are we talking about? Them that have crept in unawares, false teachers, basically. Right? And they privily bring about damnable heresies. What are heresies? They're my opinions better than your opinion, is really what it comes down to. Okay? And, you know, we can have a difference of opinion on a few minor things that, you know, maybe that aren't really clear, and we can discuss it, and we can not always necessarily 100% agree about every little detail, and we don't have to have division over that. But these are damnable heresies. This is when we're allowing it to create division and whatever. And they bring upon themselves swift destruction, and many shall follow their pernicious ways, by reason of whom the way of truth shall be evil spoken of. And through covetousness shall they with feigned words make merchandise of you, whose judgment now of a long time lingers not, and their damnation slumbers not. And then he says, if God spared not the angels that sinned, so we talked about who those were. And then it goes down to Noah, he saved Noah, the eighth person. Then in verse 6, he turned the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah into ashes, and he delivered just Lot. And it talks about that for a while. Then he drops down to verse 10, but chiefly them that walk after the flesh. Remember we talked about the difference? These have not the Spirit, they have the flesh. They walk after the flesh in the lust of uncleanness. They despise government. Same thing, despise dominions, right? They despise government. They're presumptuous, are they? They're self-willed. They're not afraid to speak evil of dignities. They'll stand and rail against leadership. Just rail against them. Whereas angels do not bring railing accusation before the Lord. Does that sound like when he said Michael did not bring a railing accusation against the one that he disputed, right? Verse 12, they're natural brute beasts. Sound familiar? They're made to be taken and destroyed. They speak evil of things they don't understand, and they will utterly perish in their own corruption and receive the reward of unrighteousness as they that count it pleasure to riot in the daytime. They're spots and blemishes. Remember, spots in your feasts are they. Sporting themselves with their own deceivings while they feast with you. They have eyes. They're full of adultery. They cannot cease from sin. Many of them testify, I sin more or less every day. I mean, that's pretty bad. I would never want that testimony. Just don't want that testimony. No, that is not a testimony you want to have. Okay? If it were true, Let's say it were true. I was really struggling, and it were true. What I would say is, I'm repenting every day. At least I turn it around to saying, I'm heading for the good land. I'm going in the right way. I am not going to remain like this. You know, goodness gracious, it's terrible. But we revel in the fact, I sin more or less every day, and so do you, and who do you think you are? And oh, it's terrible. Yeah. They receive, verse 13, the reward of unrighteousness. Verse 14, they have eyes full of adultery, cannot cease from sin. They beguile unstable souls. A heart they have exercised with covetous practice. They're cursed children. You go down to 17, they're wells without water. They're clouds. I skipped. They mentioned Balaam, same as Jude did. They're wells without water. Does that sound like familiar? Clouds that are carried with the tempest, to whom the mist of darkness is reserved forever. Does that sound like the end? They're in darkness. So I just wanted to show you that you can go read 2 Peter chapter 2, and you can go read Jude and feel like you're reading the same thing. You got two witnesses. You got Peter, the disciple of the Lord Jesus, and an apostle, and you got Jude, the brother of James, telling you the exact same story. Okay? You don't have to wonder if this is true. Okay? Because it is true. And then, just so you know, the last five verses in Jude is chapter 3 of Peter. Because he talks about, I now write unto you. But you, beloved, both which I stir up your pure minds by way of remembrance, that you may be mindful of the words which were spoken. Then he talks about what you're supposed to do. And then we're going to get to the day of the Lord comes the thief at night, which we talked about earlier, but we'll bring that up. And then he goes, verse 14, wherefore, beloved, seeing that you look for such things, be diligent to found of him in peace without spot and blameless. And account that the longsuffering of our Lord is salvation, even as our beloved brother Paul, also according to the wisdom given unto him, has written unto you, as also in all of his epistles, speaking in them of things in which are some things hard to be understood, which they that are unlearned and unstable rest as they do the other scriptures unto their own destruction. Ye therefore, beloved, beware. Grow in grace, verse 18, in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To him both be glory both now and forever. Amen. So I want to show you that it's all there. And you can just study 2 Peter and you basically get Jude, and you can study Jude and you get 2 Peter, and the two agree together, and they tell us how absolutely essential these things are to understand.